My job is mostly to work on how to gather information from open sources and often on social networks. Part of the job of our team is to make a red team mission. When we do that, it's like we have no defined perimeter, and there is companies that ask us to try to get in with any method or nearly any method. So when we have this kind of mission, the first step is to gather as many information as possible about our target. How we define the target is often we want to steal, for example, sensitive data, and we will try to look for people with access to this data. This will define our target. Then we will learn how much as possible about it, and for example, about his computer, OS, or software they use. Then I give all this information to my teammates that will try to find weaknesses, vulnerability, and develop or adapt an exploit for the mission. Then sometimes we will have to tweak the target to run our exploit, then get the data and disappear. Why I speak about that is because the presentation I will do, or I do, is about adding new tool to the Intel phase. So when I do the Intel, what am I looking for? Like I said, I will look for one or more human. I will often look for the one with access with the data, because when we will have access to the EIS computer, we won't need to do more privilege escalation, because we already have the same right as the target, and we will have access to the data we are looking for. So that's why I'm trying to, I spend time to choose the right target. Then I will look for more information about my target to be able to exploit them. And we will also often need some information about the target connection. What we may do is send documents. And in order to do that, we will probably use an email coming from someone the target knows. Or we could use social networks, for example, with Facebook or even LinkedIn. And in order to usurpate an identity, we need information too. For example, if the target and the person we want to fake use English, we will also want to know how they say hello, how they say goodbye, and fix that last to make it look real. So what we presented in 2010 in Dubai was how we can use LinkedIn and Facebook to get information about our target, and how we can use the Facebook model to make an attack and a targeted attack. Facebook is great for that because all the application, the Facebook application, are hosted on the attacker server. And on this server, you can change your code whenever you want. But you also have the Facebook ID. So it's quite easy to just send malicious code to the high target. So for our red team job, it was great. When I first look at Twitter, so some basic things, user follow all other user and share message with short message, 140 characters, often with links to other websites. And as the URL may be too long, or you do not have enough room to put your message, they will use shortcut URL that hide the real destination. So typically, this could be a great tool for us. When you see an URL, a micro URL, you clearly see that the destination is unknown before you click on it. And there could also be a problem if the micro URL service is malicious. And for us, it may be a new vector of attack. There is already a lot of things happening on Twitter. There was a JavaScript worm with XSS. There was the application scam. For example, you can use a dedicated application to use Twitter. The application will have the same weight as you, or nearly the same. And the application may do hidden things. For example, publish tweets that you didn't want the application to publish, or had friends that you do not want to follow, and things like that. There was also a story about a stolen account, but I think it's not a vulnerability in Twitter, but they found out the password or the secret answer to the mailbox and things like that. There was also a lot of cases about spam or viruses. Since you can hide the final destination, it's quite easy to send them to a fake website or things like that. And there was another conference who explained all the risks and details it very well. So why a new presentation? In my case, I do not need a large-scale attack. I'm only looking for one target. And the thing is, if I send the malicious piece, I could infect people I do not want to infect, because we have some legal constraint when we do red team things. And also, we want our attack to be as stealth as possible. So if we are able to send the malicious document to only one person, we could be less easy to detect, in fact, something like that. So my starting point was, OK, it's great. I think the model Twitter and MicroURL is not great for security. But if I have a target with a Twitter account, I am able to just own this target? So this is my question. And I didn't find any answer already published. So I will speak about Twitter. I'm sure you probably all know it. But since I will use the term a lot, I prefer to be sure. A tweet is a short message, like I said, 140 characters. A user can follow another user to get notification when the user sends new tweets. That's why it is called following a user. There is also a person who could follow your target. When you follow someone, you call the follower. And you can add a keyword on your tweets with the hash, and it's called a hashtag. So when you use Twitter and MicroURL, you will have a tweet with an URL. When you click on the link, you will be redirected to the shortening services. The shortening services will send you back the correct link, and you will finally have access to the website. You may have many URL shortening services between you and the final website you want to access. How the redirection is done? There is many ways. It's often a 301 or 302 redirection that the web server sends, saying the page is not here anymore, but you can access it using this URL. Sometimes you have a meta header. It's HTML code that say you have to refresh your web page automatically after a few seconds, here zero, and the final destination here, the one you say. There is also JavaScript possibility with, for example, location.replace, and this will send back to the, this will change the URL, and you will go to your destination. And there is even a few services that use link with a picture about the final website. And like that, you can choose to click on the link or not. We made a few tests. For example, in 2009, there was already more than 300 URL shortening services known. And there is a lot more every year. We made a short test on the 30 or 31, the more used. There was, like expected, in fact, a lot of 301 and 302 redirection That's the logical tool to make this kind of reaction. But we saw at least one with both using MITA, the HTML tag, and the JavaScript. It was Tico. This is the official redirection services of Twitter. And there was also two services using link and pre-visualization. Why this is really interesting for us? Because since I'm used to gather information, JavaScript is a great tool in order to get information about a user. I will speak about it later, but you can get nearly everything about his browser, sometimes his operating system, things like that. And the interesting thing is Tico does not always act the same depending on the user agent. For example, if you do a wget, you will have a 301 or 302 redirection. But if you use a browser like Firefox, you will have the Mita and JavaScript redirection. So this is a behavior we can use to stay still, using often 301 and 302 redirection. And when we think we have our target, we will be able to gather more information using JavaScript. And we are not the only one to do it, so it's better to stay still. So my first strategy was I will create my own URL shortening service. I will promote it, creating user and using it. I will post links with it. Then I will try to have the target use my service. There is two ways, in fact. Either I send him a link, or I hope that someone retweet one of my tweets, then the target click on it. Then if he use our service, we will try to gather information, and if we have the right exploit, or after we have developed it, we will try to own his computer. That's the basic strategy. Now, is it possible to do it? When we do our information gathering, we need many things, the target part, like what I said, but also information about the person to impersonate, the user to impersonate, the trusted connection. In Twitter case, we won't have to work on this part because the connection already exists and they are all the people the target follow. The technical information is still needed, and the defensive mechanism, it's not part of this presentation, but sometimes we can find them on LinkedIn, for example, on CV of administrator, or either on other things published. So now, how we can gather information from Twitter? So there is two ways to do it, parsing HTML. We have three sources of information, three sources. We can parse twitter.com, we can simulate Ajax from the Twitter website. We could either use mobile.twitter.com, the HTML is quite different, there is no JavaScript, so it's easier. We could also use the API offered by Twitter that are dedicated to this kind of use. But since Twitter is not really kind with people doing spam or using application to do bad things, since we still want to be as stealth as possible, we will try to act as a normal user. So we will use a browser request and things like that. So what we could do using Twitter API, but if you do Ajax request, you get the same things. We could have about a user the date of creation of the account, not really useful. The location is filled by the user, so it's not always useful too. We have the list of followers and the number of followers. That could help us to choose the target. We want someone with as many followers as possible. We will also have the number of tweets and the date of tweets. This will help us to know if the target use Twitter a lot or not, and when the target use Twitter. For example, we could choose a target that used Twitter during the work rather than just using it at home, since we want to access data. About tweet, what we have, it's a date of creations, mention user, when they said they speak or send a message to someone, they will add at the ID, user ID. We will get a list of URL and hashtags. This helps us learn about our target and its sources of interest. We will also have the reply to. This will help us learn about our target, and we will be able to know if this is the kind of way we can use to send him links. And we could, if he tweets a lot of questions and often check for answer, we could use this way to send him tweets with our micro-URL. Sometimes you have geolocalization, and also the source. This is the application used by the user to send the tweet. It's sometimes it's a great way to learn about the operating system, because some application just exist on macOS, for example, or we could learn if he uses mobile phone a lot and things like that. So now, what kind of information can we get with the micro URL services? If we use a redirection, 301, 302, we will have access to very few information. We will have access to the user agent, the referrer, but lots of links will want from t.co first. We will have the date and time of access, and the IP, and from the IP, the country. If we use JavaScript, we will be able to learn much more. We will be able to learn about the browser, about the version of the browser, about the plugin. We will also be able to learn if you use Flash, PDF, Silverlight, and this will give us much more information and much more way to attack the user. We will also be able, since we have the version, to know if we already have an exploit ready, of if we have to find a zero day. So this is a resume of the way to send information and to gather information. To send information, we have three ways, send tweets and hope that the target click on it. We could reply to some of his message. We could also send private message using Twitter. But it's quite like sending an email, so it's not really a new way to attack. To gather information and to send our exploit, we have two ways, the micro URL services, or just get access to the final website. In fact, it's nearly the same. The problematic we have, if we have our hog URL shortening services off, if we get access to the final website, is exactly the same. It will be, how can we be sure that the person using following the link is the right target? This will be the main problem. Okay, so next, my scenario now, it's I will create many Twitter users. I will probably create them with the same hobby, so I will use the same hashtag as my target. I will follow similar thematics, similar user. I can follow just his follower, or all the people followed, but the one my target follow. It's a tree. I know I will have to send a link with my service, and I will have to find a way to identify my user. So the different part, how to automatize account creation on Twitter. The constraints are we will need a full name. We will also need a Twitter name. This one needs to be unique. And we will need an email in order to validate our account. So the first step is if I want many users, I will need lots of email. So there is at least three ways to generate lots of email. The first one, it's you cannot create a Gmail account with a dash. So if I made, for example, mine, arno-masque, I'm sure this email cannot exist since you cannot create it. So I can use these tweaks to create, to give a lot of email to Twitter. Of course, I will never resave the email from Twitter, but if I just need temporary account, this works great. The other way, if I want accounts that last in time, I can reuse the same Gmail account. For example, if you add a dot in your email, it's still the same email for Gmail. So you will resave all the email on the same account. But for Twitter, it is different accounts. So this is another great way to have a lot of Gmail account. Gmail account is great because it's trusted by many services and like Facebook, for example. You could also use the Twash account or Twash webmail box, for example, on Yopmail. The thing is, you do not have to create your account first. You will just have to give your email, and you will have access to the mail. And the great way with Yopmail, it's there is a RSS feed, so it's quite easy to check if you have new mail, pass the RSS, and extract the new Twitter link. So next, we will have to find user ID that are free. And we also have to check if the email we used are not already used, for example, with Yopmail. So in order to do that, we can use the AJAX call from the main Twitter website. So there is two different ones. This is the call Twitter uses when you fill the form, when you create a new account. So it's exactly the same request. And we will have an answer to know if the ID is free and the email is free. The great thing with this call is if the ID is not available, Twitter will send you a free proposition, one to three proposition, of available ID, and you just have to get the first one, for example, and like this, you have a lot of ID available. The next step, and I thought that was the hard one, you have to bypass the captcha. The first one on Twitter.com, you won't have it each time. You will only have it if you try to create many accounts with the same IP. And the other one is the one on the mobile version of Twitter. So I thought the mobile one was easier to break, so I worked on the second one. How does it work? You have an ID in the form when you fill the user information. You have an hidden input with the ID of the captcha. And you have to give the answer to the right captcha. The great thing for us is you can answer multiple times to the same captcha. It's great, but it's still not a normal usage of the user creation. So it's not really stealth. And the problem we have is if we do that, I'm not sure I can make as many tries as I want, but even if I can, the thing is, if they found out that we use these tweaks, they will be able to ban all of our users. So it's not a great way. And even if we found a correct answer, we can't replace the answer. So that's not great too. And when we get the captcha, we have 30 minutes to answer. So it's really a lot of time, and we will we'll try to create our own OCR and get the information like that. And this captcha is not so hard to break. because you you always have six integer, so it's 10 possibilities for each integer. The police is always the same, only the same. The police is the same. The font is the same. There is no real deformation. The problem is the anti-aliasing, so it's hard to know which pixels are to the integer and not to the integer. There is also the noise on the background, but what helps us, it's always a blue, always some blue. There is still some problem when we have a big blob of white and an integer in it, but it's also a problem for a human, so we don't bother too much. And about the straight and the picture, since they nearly they start to one border to the other, you can easily identify the coordinate, guess the and guess from there all the other pixels. Oh, it's work not so bad. The only problem we may have, for example, and if we have a straight crossing a zero, it's really hard to know if it's a 8 or a 0. Okay. So now we can add a lot of users. In fact, I didn't speak about it, but there is one next problem is we need a different CPA for nearly every user, and this is really the problematic things. But now we have our user, how we can add a relation with all the people that our target follow. So there is two ways to do it. We could use the mobile website with a post request. We could use the official Twitter website with an Ajax call. Or we could use an application. The problem with the application, it's they use double authentication. There is an authentication for the user, of course, and there is also an identification for the application, since the user have to add first the application to the authorized application. Since, like I said, Twitter is not really kind with people using application to do bad things, we stayed on the first approach and we use only HTTP queries. Now we can follow a user. Then we want our account to be trustable, and in order to do that, we will need a few followers to start. So how we can do this? There is at least three methods. The first one we wanted to do, it's create a lot of bots, cross add them all together. And like that, if I have 5,000 bots, I will have 5,000 followers with each of my followers. The problem is I will need nearly one IP, IP per bot, and that's quite boring. The other solution is to buy them. It's not really expensive for 1,000 followers. The thing is, depending on the service you use, you may have your follower not following you after a few days. Another way to do it, it's to get a big file with lots of Twitter users that often follow the people that add them. We get a list of 5,000 users, I think, something like that. And it's quite easy to add 100 people each day during a month or two, and look for the one adding you back, and the one that does not add you back, you just remove the, you stop following them. There is also the hardware. It's to make a really, really interesting account. I think Lady Gaga is the one with the most followers. Or you could tweet about iPhone jailbreak. These people have lots of followers too. So now we know how to create lots of followers, how to create lots of Twitter account. We could use this user to send links using our micro URL service. So this is the first part of our strategy. Great. Now, the other problem is if our target use our micro URL service, how can we be sure that's the right target and not another user clicking our link to? And this is the trickiest part of our job. So what kind of information do we have to try to filter? With Twitter, we will have information about our target. We will know sometimes geolocalization and country. We will have a list of URL present in the precedent tweet he sent. We will know when does he tweets often, which day, when he retweet too. We will also know about his language. This could help us if the language he uses is not often used. And sometimes we will have information about what kind of tool he uses. And with this information, we may deduce sometimes the operating system, if the application is only available on a few operating systems. So how can we cross this information with what we have from the micro URL service? Geolocalization and country, we can cross it with IP. About the URL in tweet, if he often used our URL, our service, we could add a cookie to follow a user and check which URL he clicked on. About the date of tweet and retweet, we will have the date of redirection, and we can see if it matches. For example, someone often using Twitter the first hour of his work between 8 and 9. We can check when he uses our services if it does match. About the language, we will have the information in the header. And for the application and the operating system, we may have information if we use GS detection, for example. So if I take a real example with one of my workmates, Yvan Le Fou, if we check his Twitter account, he says he has another website at yvanlefou.fr. We know that his time zone is Paris, and but that's a lot of user, possible user too. His hashtag are often the more used is security and Microsoft. And with the source and the application, we also know sometimes he uses Android, his mobile phone, and sometimes he uses Chrome with the plugin Silverbird. Okay, great, but for us, that's way too many users possible. Just with this kind of information, we won't be able to use our micro URL services to identify users. So how can we get a bit more information? One way could be to use Facebook. If we know our target use Facebook, if we are able to make him use one of our applications, we could set specific cookie. Then, with our micro URL service, we could get access to the cookie, since we both own the micro URL website and the application. And with the cookie, we could retrieve the Facebook user ID. This is a very big if, because we need to have a Facebook application, things like that, and it's not a great way to do it. But we have another option that Elkemtuf published about history leak. It is a way to get information about the history of a user. That was, I will explain it a bit later. And with this solution, we could check for the list of tweets, the list of URL checked, even if he didn't use our micro URL service. And verify if it's the same tweet as all the tweets published and or match a good percentage, for example. The problem we have with this solution is If our user use many browser and his mobile phone too, for example, because the URL may be split, the history will be split on many browser, and it's still a good solution, but it's not perfect yet. What will be perfect will be to be able to check for specific URL with the precedent history leak that exists with JavaScript and CSS. It was possible to check for specific URL. And for example, if someone I'm looking for has the history twitter.com yvanlefou/list, the only user with this URL will be Yvan Lefou. So it's a great way to distinguish a user. The only problem is Elkemtuf's solution works great with CSS, PNG, JS, file like that, and not with HTML page. And we have the same things on Facebook. But the problem is, with this solution to get information about the history, it's not too possible to get to check for this URL. So, how the Elkemtuf solution works? First, a bit of history. The previous solution, in order to get access to the history, used CSS or JavaScript. And for example, in JavaScript, you checked for the style of a link. If it's blue, you know it's not visited. And if it's a purple thing, you know that the link is visited. Even if the website uses different CSS, you can set your own CSS and you can test for it. And the CSS tweaks was to use colon visited. And you set a specific ID, and if the link was visited, you looked for a specific page to load an image in the background. These two solutions doesn't work anymore on many browser, so it's we can't use this. And the problem existing with the history was it was possible to do timing attack. If the page is in cache, it will be faster for the browser to get access to the picture. The problem is, when your test is done, you will see that the browser spends more time to get the picture. But when you will try it again, the picture is in cache, so you can't use the solution two times on the same browser. So it's not great. There is a pollution of the history of the browser. The great part with this solution is there is no problem with pollution of the history. So how does it do it? First, he creates an iframe with a content he has access to. Then he do many access to the iframe. He change the destination of the iframe to the URL he want to test. And he will do many access, but stop after a few times. If he get an error with the cross-domain policy error, before the end of the time he gave, this means the page is already in cache. And to not have problem with still loading the URL, it changed the destination of the iframe to another one to prevent cache damage. So this is a great solution, and it does work very well for us. So that's what I said. It works great with CSS, picture, and JS. In his test, he said he can test about 50 URL per second. It's not really a problem for us, since our service will be used many times. We can check for URL and dispatch testing time and check if it's for the same user with a cookie. So now, how we can use this in order to attack the user we are looking for? So our target is still Yvan Lefou. I know for sure he has a blog because he put it in his Twitter information. His blog is WordPress. He is probably the only admin of his blog. And there is an admin section on his blog to put content. And on the admin section, there is picture with distinctive URL. And that's great because it's picture, it's distinctive. And if a user has this URL in his story, we know for sure that's Yvan Le Fou. So how we can do this? We will still try to be a bit stealth. So we will do a redirection in many phases. First, we will do we will put the two redirection like t.co. We will do a meta redirection that is a bit slow and a faster one in JavaScript. If the redirection is done with JavaScript, we know for sure that JavaScript is active, so it's great for us. And if it's not, we just do nothing, and like that is it's harder to detect us. Then we will check for configuration that looks like the one of Yvan Le Fou. So the IP need to be in France. We will check if he access, if he use your URL services during the afternoon or late in the night, because we know our target and we know when he tweets. We could also use a user agent since we have information about it. And we will check if it's a window user. And then we will set a specific cookie and we will see, okay, if you see this cookie again, and if JavaScript is available, just gather as many information as possible. And the another time, or if we already have the exploit working, just try to get access to his computer. So, a quick demonstration. We used a browser with an old Silverlight plugin. It was a Dreamon presentation done probably here by Workmate 2. And so I reused this exploit. We will use a link in tweet. And we will do two redirections. The first one without the history set. So it shouldn't, nothing should happen. And then with the right history, and during the redirection, we will try to own the computer if you want. Since I do not trust Yvan at all, and since he could have changed the picture on his website, I did a video demonstration. Okay. So how does this work? We fake his Twitter account. We added a tweet with a URL. And what we will do is, does it work? Yeah, great. We will empty the history because we made a MIDI test. So we will first empty the history to be sure that looks like any other user. And then we will do two-time redirection. He will go to our services. We will check for the history. If the link is not present in the history, we will directly redirect to the our blog. What I did just earlier, I still put the attacker listening on a port, and if the browser is compromised, we will have a connection on our shell. So the redirection goes well. Here, this is in.html is where we test for the history. Since the history is empty and we haven't the correct link, we finish the redirection and we are quite stealth. And there is nothing happening on the attacker side. Then we will set an history. Since I'm not yet root on his computer, I do not have this admin password, so I have to fake it. I will access to a picture of his account. And since he does know the presentation, I didn't want him to change the picture. So this is his real website. The admin is available. It's possible to see all the picture on the admin site. I choose the menu one because it's the one I'm sure I use. So my history is set now, and I will try again the redirection tweak. Okay, my attacker is still listening. I will click on the link, and here, the test of the URL is in JavaScript, and it is faster than the header, the meta header redirection. So the JavaScript is quite it's a few milliseconds, so it's quite quick. So it do another redirection we do to the pwn HTML page with a Silverlight on it, exploiting the vulnerability. And now the admin, the attacker, should have a shell on his computer, and it does work great. Okay, so here we are on the Yvan Le Fou computer. If it was Yvan Le Fou that used our service. Okay, just because I can. So next, we will have the redirection finishing. In background, I did it slow. It was voluntary, but the redirection does finish, and the attacker does go to the final destination. So we clearly did during man in the middle things, did exploit the browser and get access to his computer. Okay. Back. Is it clear? Okay. So, just to finish, to compare it to traditional social engineering attacks, we tried to do it to have an attack less direct. Because, for example, if we are retweeted by another user, it will be really harder to know that it was us that did the attack. It's also harder to know who was the target. If we send an email to the target, it's clear that the target, that the user is the target. With this kind of attack, it's harder to know it. I also think users tend to learn. So when they receive email, they will be less prone to click on a document. Not sure, but I think. And Twitter is designed to share links and is designed to have user click on links. So it's great. User tend to click. I'd like to say some other things. I still think the risk is low. It won't break the internet. If our target use different clients, it will, like different browser and his mobile phone, it will be much harder to find the correct target. But we still have some tricks to we can use. I think JavaScript is a big tell that we are doing not nice things, but we are not the only one to use it. So this help. And of course, we need other vulnerabilities, sometimes ODAI, so it's not exactly an easy attack. And Twitter really makes spam difficult for users. There is lots of protection to ban users and things like that. But anyway, it does work. This demonstration, even if it's a video, shows that we can do it. And all the tools already exist. For me, it's not that much that I will just use this, but it's great for our red team job because I had other tools. I could use an email, I could use Facebook, I could use LinkedIn. Now I also have some outs with Twitter, and for us it's great. Okay, I kept 10 minutes, I think. So if you have questions.
Hello, my name is Bas de Heer from Society the Netherlands. What is your time frame usually? How long do you have to set up an attack?
It really depends on the user and how easy it will be for him to trust us or no, and how much we want to stay stealth. But it's, I think it's a long attack. You will need just to get a real user with a lot of followers, probably a few weeks at least. But you could also use another approach. That is, I want to create a real micro URL services and make it make the service used. And in 1 year, 2 years, when I will really need it, I will use it to hound some user. So it's two different approach, depends on the one you want to use. This is also a way to say, it's hard to see it, but be careful when you use micro URL service.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, thanks. Thanks for the talk. I want to know, did you try to estimate how many, the percentage of clicks you have, just suppose you register N users or you buy N users? And then I want to know, I mean, if you post like post a day for a month, how many of your friends visit the link you have post, and how many of them then contain, are using a browser that may be vulnerable to some zero-day attack in the browser?
No, we didn't do we'll test in live because we had many problems, and one of them was our legal department not too happy that we do this kind of test online. So we just did the POC things. Yeah,
it makes sense. That's usually a problem in this kind of experiment. Because the question that rises is, this kind of attack has more impact than using, for example, Facebook, for example, setting up some fake profile on Facebook and posting some content there. So it's Twitter more used, or user trust more Twitter than other networks. But if you cannot measure it, okay, it's just a poke.
I'd like also to add that it's not a tool that you will use anytime or for any target. Depending on the target you have and what you learn about your target, often you can know if he retweets a lot. For example, for Yvan, I think it's something like 80% or 70% of retweets. So you know that it will probably be easier to target it with this kind of tweaks rather than another one. If you see that the person also has a Facebook account with 500 or 600 friends, you will probably choose another vector.
Okay, thanks.
All right, I think we have time for more questions, if there are any. No? Okay, well, Arno, thank you very much for your talk. Thanks.